We want to start now?
We have 18 participants, so that's good, I guess.
Okay, so let's start. Right, so hello to everybody, and thank you for joining us today for this OLAB lecture series. Today, we welcome Professor Philippe Poncet from the University of Pau and Pays de l'Adour, which is a university located southwest of France. Professor Poncet is a professor in applied mathematics and is now the vice president in charge of the digital environment in this university. Before that, he has been the head of the numerical methods and complex fluid team. And he is an expert in the numerical modeling of flow in complex geometries, including the flow in pores. And I think this is related to what he's going to tell us about today. So Professor Poncet, thank you first for being here with us. And the floor, or the screen, should I say, is yours.
Okay, thank you for the presentation. And also thank you for inviting me. It's a real pleasure to do this PORLAB lecture. So in this talk, I will spend a few minutes to present you my university and the city of Pau. It may be interesting for everyone to know each other, like with this kind of opportunities. And then at the scientific level, I will present you some usual and simple models for pore scale computation and modeling. And I will focus on a particular kind of methods, which are called particle methods and vortex methods. And then I will present you a few success stories using these particle methods for one-phase flows, Newtonian and non-Newtonian flow in porous media at the pore scale. And then I will focus to some simulation with reaction and dissolution process. That's my goal in this talk, and then make some concluding remarks. So, so the city of Pau, it's located in, as you said, Tom, in the southern part of France here. And it's a university of medium size in France. It's 14,000 students in five campuses, one very close to the coast and the others close to Pau. Our size is almost 800 teaching and research positions. And we have a funding agency called E2S, dedicated to energy and environment. And it's a kind of agency aiming at funding a project on energy and environment, including porous media. In my research federations, we have five labs, the labs of mathematics and application, the lab on complex fluids and reservoirs, whose total is partly managing the unit. DMEX, a unit dedicated to experimental and tomography. LATEP, a lab dedicated on process and chemical engineering, and electrical and mechanics in SIAM. So we have five labs. Often working together. And we have, of course, strong links with Total, the oil company, whose headquarters are located in Pau. And we have two common research cells, Chloé focusing on EV oils, and Opera on, focusing on seismic imaging. And we have Carnot Institute dedicated to the fossil resource. So it's a... also a funding agency. So here is our scientific environment. And the city of Pau, it's a city very close to the mountains from the city center here up Here, it's a picture from the city center. We can see the mountains from the Pyrenees. And we have the castle of Henri IV, a famous king, who ended the wars of the religion war between Protestant and Catholics in France. So it was a peaceful area, and we have some famous food and wines also, and a university, maybe less famous than the wine, but pretty good university. And close to the city, I have to switch here, okay. Close to the city, we have mountain where we can ski, and we have two famous cities, Saint-Jean-de-Luz, with a nice, very nice bay in the Pays Basque, and Biarritz, also a famous city. Some sports, and everything is close, less than 1 hour from the city of Pau. So let's hope that one day, when COVID will be over, you will have the opportunity to visit all this. Okay, so it was my three slides about the environment, the surrounding areas. So now about science. Some models. There are a lot of models for pulse media, pour scale or not, but I will focus on one in particular, based on the Stokes equation. So we are talking about microfluidics, and in microfluidics, we often at a simple level consider the Stokes equation So I present very briefly the notation. U is a velocity, a dynamic viscosity, a permeability K, an external force, and a pressure gradient. So the Brinkman-Stokes is simply the Stokes equation with a linear term here, involving a permeability. So this permeability can be variable in space, and on that level, we can see another model, which is very close and actually quite equivalent, the penalized Stokes equation. You still have a Stokes equation on this part, and you consider the characteristic function of a body, of a solid part. So here, if you take a cut of a porous stone with a very large pore here, in black you have a body, a solid body, and in white you have a fluid, sometimes with inclusions, sometimes with throats and small pores, and an interface sigma between the two. So it's a very ideal case, but we can already have a lot of physics in this kind of configuration and model. So if I consider the characteristic function here, which is 1 in the solid and 0 in the fluid, and a small parameter epsilon, okay, it's equivalent to the Brinkman-Stokes with a variable permeability term, variable in space, and it will be very large in the solid domain, so we can almost forget everything, and you have U equal to 0 in this case, and in the fluid you have this characteristic function equal to 0, so you have a Stokes equation, and the main advantage of this kind of formulation is that you can have a square computational domain. You have to take care of the boundary conditions, of course. It's a problem in itself, but we can manage it several ways to manage the boundary condition. But with a discontinuous, strongly discontinuous due to the 1 over epsilon term, you can have a simple geometry for your computations, and then use very fast numerical methods. Another way to see that kind of model, the equivalence between the two, is the Kosenik-Arman law. I will come back to it very often. I mean, if you consider the inverse permeability as a bulk permeability K0, with a fraction using the porosity, the local porosity phi. Okay, so your local porosity is a one in the fluid. So this term k inverse is zero. Okay, and in the solid part, phi is equal to something close to zero, and this phi to the three behaves exactly like epsilon here. So the Kosinski-Kármán law gives an equivalence between the penalization and the Brickman-Stokes, and it allows to quantify the boundary layer and the transition close to the boundary of a penalization using this kind of law. And if you can extend it to the famous DBS model, which is a Darcy-Brinkman-Stokes, which is a kind of Navier-Stokes equation. Okay, except that you have a porosity here, 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 and here. And of course, in the Kosinski-Kármán method term. So it's a kind of Navier-Stokes equation, but modified. And if you are in the hypothesis that you can neglect this and this, in practice in microfluidics, then you can reduce this DBS model to this kind of expression. Okay, so it's very close to a Stokes equation. I guess you had Cyprien Soulen a few weeks ago giving a talk in your lab. So he's also working with these kind of models. Well, okay. So I will use EVLI, the penalization techniques. And now I can show you the particle methods. So it's the theoretical part of my talk, and after I will focus on mainly on applications. Okay. So if we consider a Navier-Stokes equation, okay, it's a first step usually in fluid mechanics. Okay, so you have a convection term, a diffusion term with this shear height tensor, with divergence-free hypothesis for incompressibility. And the idea of vortex and particle methods is to take the curl of this equation. Okay, so you consider the curl of the velocity. So this omega is the vorticity. The omega is the vorticity here. And if you take the curl of this whole equation, everything that is linear becomes, you just only changes the velocity in the vorticity. Okay. I assume the density to be constant here and here to make just the slide more readable, because it's of course it's you can use it with variable density, but it's just easier to write. So if you take the curl of this non-linear term, because it is the only one to take care with, you get here u dot nabla omega plus omega nabla u. Okay, it's non-linear, so you have two terms when you take the divergence of this expression. It splits in two. Okay, and this one just becomes this one. You have only one term in the derivation d due to the incompressibility, so it's quite classical. But with these two terms in blue, with these two terms in blue, you have one which is transport, okay, and one which is stretching. Okay, it's the nature is very different. And in practice, what you can do to compute u and omega is to introduce the stream function psi, okay, which is solution of a Poisson equation, and then once you have the stream function, you take the curl to get the velocity. So you can go straightforwardly from the velocity to the vorticity, and using the stream function, you can construct from the vorticity, you can construct the velocity. Okay, so you can go from one to the other, and the idea of particle methods is to introduce some triplets with a volume Vp at one place, a small volume whose center is Xp, the position is Xp, and you consider an element of vorticity on that cell. Okay, so it's to the opposite of Eulerian methods, like finite element methods or any other spectral FFT methods or anything else. You can get some mobile cells. You have a position here, and it's a Lagrangian method we consider. So you can fill your whole domain with particle of volume Vp. So at the beginning, of course, you put it on a grid. It's you have to do it the most easily possible when you can afford it. And if our system is described by this, okay, we can check that the variation of vorticity. It's only a function of t, of the time t. If you take its evolution, okay, it's a solution of this term, which is the right hand side here. And the position is only pushed by the velocity. So it's quite usual in Lagrangian methods. You follow the characteristic field of velocity, and the volume is solution of this, but due to the incompressibility, you don't even have to compute it. It's not evolving. It remains at zero, so you keep your Vp constant. And if you have a compressible effect, then you can adapt. But the most interesting thing is that this term disappears because it's taken into account in this expression. Okay, and this term is annoying in practice because you have a stability condition on this, because it's a transport equation. So the CFL, the current Friedrich-Levy condition, the CFL condition here, is prohibitive often. And since it is removed, the CFL is removed also. So it's a robust method. It's what we call a robust method because you don't have transport CFL, okay? And it's quite flexible because you can use anything you want to integrate this dynamical system. You take multi-step, you take your favorite Runge-Kutta method, whatever, Lobato scheme, whatever you want. It can be very flexible. And it scales as n log n, n being the number of particles, which means the number of grid points if you start with a grid to put your particle on it. Okay, so it's the main advantages. The main drawback is that you don't have many libraries to make the computation. And you have a lot of code to do. Usually, as soon as you change something, you have to code it because it doesn't exist. And the key point here is that it's semi-Lagrangian. Okay, I mean everything is Lagrangian here, but in red, you can compute efficiently a Poisson equation and compute a curl much more efficiently if you compute it on a grid. So the idea is to use in high order interpolation between grid and particle, so you have a large set of particles here describing your system, and then your omega, you can interpolate it on a grid, then compute the stream function on the grid, and then use straightforward finite difference schemes to get your u, your vitesse, your velocity u, and then you can interpolate it back to particles to push in time this part and this part. Okay, so the key point is to make it high order for this interpolation, because if you are not accurate in this step, you are not accurate for everything. So it's the main idea is here. And if you add some passive or active quantity, in practice, the chemistry, that's why it's a concentration, usually I denote it C. Your chemical quantity is solution of diffusion transport with a reactive term here. And we can have the same idea. I mean, you make it you define particles here, but instead of taking a vorticity, you take an element of concentration, and the same idea applies. You can push it with a velocity field and make it reactive, and using a diffusion at that point where you have your concentration. So you can add a quantity, and you can make it Lagrangian as well as here for the hydrodynamics, and it works too. So it's very useful, even if you are in microfluidics and you don't have this term, you don't have this term, you don't have this term. So it's much more simple in microfluidics, but you still have this one which is dominant here, and the blue term of transport for your chemistry is removed, so the stability condition, the CFL condition, is also removed, even if you are in microfluidics. Okay, so it's interesting, even if you are in microfluidics and you don't have the transport in the hydrodynamics. Well, to end it, you just have to make it work to add the penalization I mentioned just earlier. So the penalization, you can add it here. So it's just going to the right hand side if you need or not. And since we take the curl of all this, it appears to be a curl. And this one, you have to be careful with this term, because it's not continuous, it's discontinuous, and strongly discontinuous due to the 1 over epsilon. And you take the curl of it, and it's singular. So you have to deal with the singularity. It's a difficult problem. It could be a seminar in itself to manage this, but it can be manageable, just because when you are you have your discontinuity, your u is converging toward zero when epsilon is going to zero, so it's not that bad, but it's still singular, and you have to be clever. Okay, so for the numerical analysis, it's all what I wanted to show you, and now I will apply this to examples. So first, some historical conditions, some historical consideration. This kind of algorithm and method have been improved in multiscale. Originally, it was developed for aerodynamics, and with all the improvement that occurred for the last 20 or 30 years, it's still scaling as n log n, so it's very efficient. Okay, and in practice, this kind of method is very, very old. We can see some definition of the vortex method by Rosenhead in the early last century with this kind of illustration. Okay, it was computed by hand with a Biot-Savart method. And Chorin in 1973 made some computation of wakes using this kind of method with particle methods. So it's quite old. It's quite old, but actually, the first proof of convergence mathematically was made in 1982. So it's late actually compared to the finite element methods. That's mainly why in industry the finite element methods became more famous, more popular than the vortex and vortex or all many other mathematical methods for hydrodynamics. Because in the end of the 60s, you had convergence for the finite element method. And it's more than 20 years after. So in 20 years, you make it advanced. So the vortex method were a bit late compared to other methods for the mathematical proofs. But now, we have modern particle methods. And I will show you in Porskell simulation. It's very useful when transport is dominant, when you transport a concentration for particle tracking or transport of tracers and concentration. It's very useful to have a method dedicated to transport. A problem in complex geometries. So it's kind of used now. Okay. So for the particle methods, that's it. And now a few examples of one-phase flows, non-reactive in Porskell geometries. So what we are doing with it, so what I explained to you, the first step is the use of the penalized Stokes equation. So it's standard, okay, it's very standard. But from tomography, if you consider a bead stack, some balls, okay, put the ones on top of the others and pressed, with a X-ray tomography, you get this kind of pictures. And with a threshold, you can reconstruct your spheres, okay, and get a real geometry from it. So we can test our methods, mainly the Stokes part. Okay, and it was with satisfaction we got some velocity fields compute the right way with vorticity. Okay, one of the advantage of using the vorticity. Is that you are sure with this kind of computation that your velocity is divergence free. Okay, since you get it in the end, you are sure that you are always divergence free. Okay, that's so for conservation, it's quite useful. Okay, so we can illustrate the complexity and scalability with a very high definition geometries. Here we have the pores and we computed the velocity in these pores with the highest velocity are in in red in the pore. Okay, and the advantage of such you know all this very well, I think, since you all work in Porskell, the universe of Porskell geometries. So 1000 to the 3, you may not consider it like very high definition, but geometry, but to compute velocity, it's well, it becomes to be anyway a serious challenge. Okay, so the advantage with high definition simulation is that you can zoom and zoom and zoom, and you still have information locally and globally with one data set. Okay, so it's if you want more detail on this, you can. It's pretty new paper. So every time I will show you something. In this part, I won't give you a lot of details, but I always give the appropriate paper. If you want details, you can have a look on this. And this kind of simulation, what I just showed you, is that if you couple it to a transport term for which you have here in blue an initial concentration of a fluid, and you push it and you get the pore scale evolution of this chemical component. Okay, and you can use it to make the upscaling. There is a small typo here, sorry. You can use it to make homogenization and upscaling to the superficial velocity model. The usual one by Kantar and Whittaker. When you can see one scale above, you have to introduce some terms and making some DNS, some direct numerical simulation at the pore scale is useful to upscale the transport. You can also do it for diffusion, which is called the Archilo. If you take several slices and you make it, you let it diffuse at the pore scale, you can get the right exponent for the effective diffusion model at the scale above. Okay. So again, in this paper, it explains how you upscale. Okay, so that's the interest of high definition simulations. So the step after was to perform non-Newtonian simulation, so you have a very strong coupling. So I began with the Stokes model, the linear Stokes model, without a transport of a species, and now I have a species whose concentration is variable in time and space, I will add viscosity depending on the concentration and the shear rate. So it's called the shear thinning phenomena, it's a rheology, and the fluid I consider is a xanthan. Okay, so it's a biopolymer, it's used in food industry and in EOR sometimes. I illustrate it for the food industry because you can find a xanthan in almost everything you buy. In juice, but also in sauce, and your salad leaves are usually coated with xanthan to make it conservable. So you have xanthan almost everywhere. But in EOR, it's used to alter the property of the flow. At the pore scale. So the law we have, the rheology we have for the dynamic viscosity, it depends on the concentration and the shear rate, D. Okay. So you have the solvent viscosity, usually it's water or brine in EOR, you have viscosity at rest, and some parameters, the exponent, the index, and all these exponents, the viscosity at rest and the slope position and the index depend on the concentration. So we had some feet for the xanthan where you can plot the viscosity versus the shear rate for several concentrations. Okay, so we can identify this law completely. It's no longer in press, it's a typo. It was even published 1 year ago. I forgot to update this, sorry. Here it's okay. So the application here and for this talk, the interest of this is to show that the coupling, the strong coupling between all these quantities can work very well with particle methods. So here we get Bentheimer geometry. It's a Bentheimer stone. Okay, you have water here, and water in below. It's taken in a cell here, in the impermeable cell, and the high concentration are in red. Okay. The lower concentration are in red but transparent, and when the polymer is not present, it's in blue, it's water. Okay, and then you push it, and you can see that you have a very complex behavior, because sometimes the concentration of biopolymer moves by diffusion, okay, and sometimes it moves by convection. Okay, in transparent here in the red you have the initial condition, and then after a given time you have the solid surface, so it can move like this by transport or by diffusion like this. Okay, so you can have both the phenomena, and it can be very complex when you use rheology for your simulations. Okay. Well, so it's completely coupled here. It's completely coupled between C, the shear height, the viscosity, and completely nonlinear. Okay. And well, sometimes you can have a quantity that doesn't move very much. Okay. And after a time, the shear height alters completely and it becomes to be very fast here. Okay, you have the same times between here and here and here and here, and it can move very quickly due to shear height and shear thinning effects. Well, so now reaction diffusion and dissolution process at the pore scale with evolving interface, that's the next step. And here I consider some calcite dissolution. Okay, my focus is on calcite dissolution with hydrochloric acid. So the molecular expression of this reaction is at the top here, and the ionic description is at the bottom. So everyone here probably knows what happens when you put a calcite in hydrochloric. You have dissolution. So your acid is consuming the calcite. So this is solid. And this is not stable, and this is gaseous, and okay, water. And, well, so I focus on this part, okay. So the one phase part here. And as a model, okay, we recover our Stokes equation. So now epsilon is the local porosity. And so it's the model I showed you a bit earlier, except that we have some reaction term here, evolution of the porosity with a specific surface and equilibrium. It's quite classic. It's first order reaction with a molar volume here. So the porosity is dimensionless here. And you have a kind of EV side. Just to stop the reaction when you're at this place, you have only fluid. Okay, your reaction stops because you have no longer any dissolution of solid, since there is no solid anymore. So the H is zero if epsilon is one, and one if epsilon is strictly positive. And the concentration of acid here. So it's one specie over one specie for the reaction. It's A plus B gives C, typically. Well, C. But here it's the concentration of acid with the transport. So it's defined inside the solid matrix. I assume it to be porous. Okay, so we have an archilo here, which means that the diffusion inside the solid depends on the local porosity, and you have your reaction rate here. Okay, plus incompressibility. So this is the complexity, the next level of complexity. And here we have diffusion and Archilo, which is linear with to the molecular diffusion. Okay, and the physical porosity in our crystal, in our calcite crystal, which is between these two values. It's physical. And we have to consider it in our problem, since the reactions are volumic here. It's not located on the surface, but located in the volume. Okay. And our test case was a cell of calcite here in a reactive cell. And the experiment from Sophie Roman showed at different times the evolution of the surface. Okay, and it's a good test to check if a method is good or not. At least if a method is able to simulate this kind of process. So it was developed in this publication. It's open access, so you can feel free to read it. And we compared this process, this dissolution process, with several numerical methods and computational codes, with Schomburg Crunch from Berkeley, with OpenFOAM, based on also on a DBS method, but not using vorticity. It uses finite volume with Lattice-Boltzmann, and DissolFOAM, another version of OpenFOAM, dedicated to reactive process, and the vortex method in blue. Okay, and it was a good surprise to see that we could blindly accord to the simulation, to the result, and all the numerical methods with the same parameters were able to reproduce this dissolution quite accordingly. So it was some good news. Even if the dissolution rate were a bit different here, but not that different actually, but the surface was and the volume were quite accordingly simulated. Okay, and if I show you the complexity of this process, I show you here a 2D release of this simulation. I have a bit less than 10 minutes usually to finish. I hope it will be okay for you. If we consider a 2D configuration with a calcite core here and some acid coming at pH 2. Okay, we can simulate it. And what is happening is that you have your calcite core here with its porosity here, which is plotted. The vorticity, the velocity, and the product concentration. And here the acid concentration and the reaction rate here. Okay, so at the beginning, you can see that in half a second, okay, you have an hydrodynamic scale. Okay, it's the time that your acid comes from here to here. It's half a second. Okay, so the reaction rate begins here. Okay, and you have some equilibrium with the Stokes flow. And after a bit more than 1 second, all your domain is filled with acid, except inside the body. But you have here it's important to have a correct Archilo to make the diffusion inside the body physical. And you have your evolution, your interface evolution after something like 45 minutes. Okay, so it's quite different scale. It's a different time scale. Okay, and then you have your reaction rate located at the interface. And then it's completely solved after something like 100 minutes. So it's very multi-scale, especially since that here you have a hydrodynamic scale less than 1 second, but your usually your time step is subject to the CFL, to the stability condition, and it's 10 to the minus 4 in practice. It's long simulations and strongly multi-scale in time. So that's what I wanted to show you with this 2D simulation. It's to focus on the multiscale aspect, and we used our method for dissolution of for internal flow at the pore scale on a real geometry. Okay, so it's a cut of our sample here. So it's a sample of sandstone, and we put acid. So at the beginning, actually, we push acid in the domain here, but it's consumed at the time it comes into the rock, and due to the dam color and peclet configuration we had here. So it reacts strongly here, and it's the initial sample is here with a cut, a different cut to see the geometry. So it's quite porous, it's 25% porous. And then after a time, you get an evolution of the fluid-solid interface here. The porosity is decreasing, and your acid is filling much more efficiently to make it react in the solid. And at the end, you have big wormholes here due to the preferred path. But the preferred path is building itself. Well, it's classical wormholes, and you have an evolution of your geometries. Okay, so you can have details of this simulation in this paper. It's last published last year in the Advances in Water Resources. For this simulation, a good thing to plot what is happening is the time derivation of the porosity. Okay, so it's an isosurface, and we can have a look of the reactive surface. Actually, it shows where the reaction occurs. So not inside the pore, not inside the solid matrix, and it shows the part of the pore scale geometry which is impacted by the chemistry. And in ours, we can see the permeability here. So the permeability is 10 to the minus 12 at the beginning, roughly. And of course, the permeability increases and the porosity increases, but there is a time where the permeability increases much more. Okay, when you have the cut-through process, then after, once you have the wormhole percolating completely, it becomes faster and faster. Okay, and another simulation interesting made with this method is a non-percolating carbonate rock. So it's different from the last one. The last one was percolating from the beginning, even if the acid was consumed. Okay, it was you had a percolation between the two faces, the top and the bottom. But here it's not percolating. The pores are in blue and the geometry is in gray. Okay, so, it's the full sample here. And here in this cut, I show you the velocity, the superficial velocity. You have some the pores are completely isolated from, but the matrix, the rock matrix, is porous. And it's the opportunity to simulate the percolation process. Okay, at the beginning, so I make a zoom on this this part because it was the most heterogeneous one. In this, if I make a zoom here, in the pink you have the different concentration of acid. The more it's dark pink, the more it's concentrated, and the more it's transparent, the less it's concentrated. Okay, so at the beginning you have, in the black you have the product of the reaction. Okay, so at the beginning you have this kind of geometry. It's not percolating, but you have some diffusion inside, and after a while your wormhole is building itself until it it crosses the box. And well, we can see that the velocity is higher and higher. In blue you have small velocity, and in the yellow you have high velocity. It's not very high anyway, but well, so it was a percolating process in that kind of geometry. It was another challenge. Okay, so to conclude this kind of method, the particle methods need a lot of development. So we are extending it to GPU and to GPU computing. Actually, it's already very advanced. We build the library ISOP focused on that kind of application. The last simulation for percolating and non-percolating dissolution process were already made in this library, so it's advanced and it's already working, but still a lot of development to do to make it everything work fine on GPU. It's still young methods in geoscience. It's not very common to use particle methods like this in geoscience and also in health science. But we can see by the different illustration I have shown that there is a good potential. Due to the scalability and the complexity of this method, we currently make an intensive use of this method to make some sensitivity studies and uncertainty analysis. And as a global conclusion, I would say that all methods are good as long as they are efficient and consistent. I mean sufficiently accurate and efficient. I mean good complexity, less than n square, scalable and fast in practice. So as long as they are efficient and consistent, we all use and build good methods. There is no method above others. And what I see particularly good for particle-based methods is that it's a good alternative for cross-validation when you have a new topic to study. To make some computation together with finite element or finite volumes method or lattice Boltzmann or any other one, to make this simulation work together increases the quality of the result and the trust we can put in the results. And that's why it's important to develop numerical methods completely different from one another. It's because to study new topics, it's an advantage to have several numerical methods available. And I would thank you all for your attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Poncet, for this very interesting talk.
Oh, just call me Philippe, please.
Philippe, then, do we have some question from the audience for Philippe? As usual, you can either turn on your camera and microphone, or you can use the chat if you prefer to do so.
I don't have the chat, actually.
You should be able to display it, but I will anyway read the question that might be written in the chat.
Hi, could you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Thank you for Professor Poncet's good presentation. I'm an LLVM user, so I also do the work related to the distribution simulation. And when I use LLVM, I find that if I use a high packet number, is there some, how to say, unstable errors, something occurs. So I want to know, in your method, what is the limitation for the packet number? It can very high.
So the packet number, but the limitation, I don't have the number right now. The limitations, maybe sometimes you have to split your diffusion for some ranges of packet number. So the advantage of particle method is that you can use large time steps or with small time step and handle large packet numbers. Okay, but you cannot multiply the limit packet number by 100 anyway, especially due to the geometry. There is you should, if you want some limitation of what was considered for the packet number in okay. In this paper, there is a discussion of the packet number. Okay, we use the three different packet numbers, so you can take a snapshot and have a look, or just take the DOE here. There is a discussion of the packet number from, I think the range is 1,000 from the smallest to the largest. So you can have details on the. In this paper.
I also already read this paper. Yeah, it's a very good paper. Yeah, but in prose media, maybe, how to say? Of course, when we define the packet number, how to say, in prose media, maybe some different ways to define the packet number.
You mean if you have an upscaled an upscaled model, which is not at the pore scale?
Yes, pore scale. I mean, in my simulation, by the definition in my research of the packet number, if it's maybe more than 50, it's will unstable. Yeah, the simulation will unstable.
I get it. You mean here it's an external flow, okay? So we can handle several packets, but okay. But in this kind of simulations here, it's internal flow, so you have a different behavior for your I get it. We made it only for one packet number, so if you increase it. It depends how it becomes unstable, but when you use particle methods, okay, mm-hmm. since you don't have your stability condition for transport, your main enemy is that your particle can go inside artificially inside the body, the solid body. That's the main thing you have to avoid. So you have to control you have to control this. So your Peclet number is, well, depends on your geometry. I don't have the same constraint because it doesn't become unstable. You lose your acid artificially, but you never become unstable since you don't have, as long as your diffusion condition is satisfied. Okay, you have to satisfy your stability condition and diffusion anyway. So once this is done, actually, that's I have no stability problem. Only you have to check where is going your acid. Whatever the Peclet.
Yeah. Mm. Okay. Have you read the other papers for this method? Yeah. Oh, thank you for your answer.
Do we have another question for Philippe? I have one, maybe.
Yeah.
So you mentioned the modeling of very viscous fluids, like xanthan-based products. In your modeling, can you actually account for any sense of wall slip? Because for this thin shearing fluids, when sometimes some of them they will display some very strong wall slip in some loading configurations. Do you?
Yes, I do, because I have spent the last few months on this problem. It's just submitted, so we ended with something. Yeah, so the slip flows is a thing. Yeah, because okay, if you had some slip flows at the boundary, okay, you have to make it a cure with the penalization here, because we have the computational box. Okay, this thing is one in the rock and zero in the fluid. Okay, and to make it work easily like this, written like this, you have to set a boundary condition on the velocity itself. I mean, it's a Dirichlet, a non-homogeneous Dirichlet condition. Okay, you have a residual slip here, but it's supposed to be small as epsilon goes to zero. Okay, so you have two strategies to make slip flows with that. Either you take a large epsilon and you hope, you cross your finger for to get the physical slip. So I think it's called the Jones boundary condition, but you only get a global slip. Locally, you don't control anything, okay? And I have tried to take so another strategy is to take a very small epsilon and here to set instead of U the slip condition, the Navier condition, okay? U plus the flux times the slip length, okay? And I penalize this relation, okay? And I hope that at the boundary I get the right slip. And actually, it doesn't work. It's a lot of effort. I have seen two PhD theses on this with zero results. And actually, I understood quite recently why, because this is imposed inside the solid part. So you can control your slip inside the solid part. But since you have two second order derivation, one derivation here, one derivation here, it's a second order PDE, and you get a slope discontinuity at the interface. So you get your right slip, but inside the solid and in the fluid, you cannot control it because your slip is, your slope and the velocity is disrupted.
Okay.
So it cannot work. So we have taken quite recently the strategy to make a finite difference code apart to get the slip and an immersed boundary instead of penalization. It's a loss of time if you use penalization for a slip flow, locally controlled. That's my conclusion.
Okay. Thank you very much. Right, so if we don't have any more questions, maybe we can hear.
Okay, so thank you very much. I was very happy to show you these works.
And thank you for presenting it, and hopefully travels between Po and Oslo will be possible in the near future.
Oh, great.
Right, thank you very much.
Thank you.